Here we are, Devlog number 10, and it's all about one of the hardest parts when it comes to building 3D experiences for the web, responsive. The thing with the web is that people expect it to work regardless of the conditions in which they are navigating. It can be with a very old broken smartphone in a subway tunnel with poor bandwidth, it needs to work and it needs to work fast. Usually, I do this part at the very end of the project, when everything is well set, but not this time. I'll be honest, I hate this part so much that I tend to botch it. Which is why I decided to do it a little bit early in the process, so that I can allocate enough time to the task and keep on improving it while finishing the project. But what is responsive exactly? The most well-known aspect of responsive is the size of the screen, more precisely, the resolution of the viewport. Unlike console games that will run on 16:9 screens, or PC games that will run full screen most of the time on common screen resolutions, web users tend to have all sorts of resolutions. Sometimes with a bunch of browser bars, sometimes on mobile devices, and obviously in portrait mode too. And I'm kind of a bad example because I use my browser on one half of the screen most of the time. Yep, in portrait mode. Another aspect of responsive is how the user interacts with the experience. The most traditional way is with a mouse and a keyboard, and according to my old portfolio stats, corresponds to most of the visitors I get. But mobile users can't be ignored, and I can't expect them to use something else than their fingers to navigate. And there is a third way to navigate, something that is really not necessary, but I really wanted to have: gamepads. I've had fun before with gamepads on an experiment I did a while back with a robot controlled with a PlayStation controller. Since my portfolio is more of a game than a website, I felt the need to add gamepad support. Finally, the third aspect of responsive is about performance. And I want the portfolio to work as best as possible on every device, including potato PCs and mobiles, even if it means removing non-key features. But this will be for later video because I haven't done the general optimization phase yet, so it wouldn't make sense to do the responsive optimization now. Up until now, I made sure that the experience was working well with a 16:9 resolution. But now I need to make sure that it works well in all sorts of resolutions, including portrait orientation and wider screens. For the anecdote, I remember working for a client with the absolute worst resolution I've ever seen with such a wide screen. Curious, we asked the client to send us a screenshot. It was a weird laptop with an unusually wide screen. He had an oddly big Windows bar at the bottom and a ton of browser bars at the top. Anyway, I managed to make everything fit nicely and the client was happy. When using three.js, we define a field of view for the camera. This field of view corresponds to the vertical angle, not the horizontal angle. As a result, when the aspect ratio changes, objects at the top and bottom will stay where they are, but objects on the left and on the right will hide or reveal. This means that a wider resolution shouldn't be an issue, but a taller resolution will be a problem, especially where it's already a tight fit. First thing I did was to calculate what I call a ratio overflow by comparing the ideal ratio, so 16:9, to the viewport ratio with this formula. To put it in a nutshell, 1920x1080 and wider resolutions will result in a ratio overflow of 0. But narrower resolutions will result in a higher overflow. As an example, 1500x1080 will result in a ratio overflow of 0.28. and taller resolutions will have a ratio overflow even bigger than that. Using this ratio overflow, I move the camera away from the car so that we can see further left and right. I also used it in what I call the cinematic view, which is when the camera focuses on something, in this case the lab area and the project's area. And again, I move the camera away so that it fits horizontally. Unfortunately, this makes the project info very small, but I haven't come up with a better idea yet. The only HTML UI I have so far is for the models. Using classic CSS media queries, I made sure everything fits nicely, even in portrait. When I create the initial world, I calculate some optimal coordinates in order to make components fit as tightly as possible, like for the grass, the terrain, and the water surface. Those take time to recalculate because it implies recasting, a lot of math, and rebuilding some geometries. When resizing the viewport, the page will trigger a lot of resize events. And doing all those instructions when the event happens would be really bad in terms of performance, resulting in long unnecessary freezes when resizing. This is why I implemented a throttled resized event. As long as I resize, no event is being triggered. But whenever I stop, it triggers only one event. And there we go. I recalculated the optimal coordinates, updated the fog, resized the water surface, recreated the terrain geometry, updated the shadow map, and recreated the grass geometry. Speaking of the grass, I made sure not to add too many blades and increased their width and height to compensate instead. At this moment, without a keyboard, there is no way to move the car. On my old portfolio, I implemented this kind of joystick for touch screens, which is what I like to call the nipper. Even though it was simple and efficient, it had three issues. Non-gamers had troubles navigating. You need to use both of your thumbs to move the car. I don't like having 2D UI spoiling the experience. Still, I try to implement a 2D nipper again, but with extra features. First, it only shows up when we touch the screen. It is centered where the finger touched first. The speed depends on the distance to the center, so no need of a second thumb. There are forward and backward areas to control the car direction. And if we go full throttle, it activates the boost. Not bad, but even I had trouble navigating with it. So I went for the hard way, the 3D nipple. Exactly the same idea as for the 2D nipple, but in 3D. The whole shape is done using TSL shader on a ring geometry. I'm not proud of the shader and how complex it is, but all those angle, SDF functions, outlined, etc. got the best of me. For it to work, I had to deactivate the easing on the view so that the car stays at the exact center of the screen. And as a bonus, tapping the inner circle makes the car jump. Even though it's still not as easy as with a keyboard, this version feels a lot more natural. Next, with touch screens, I wanted to implement view controls so that the user can move the camera around without having to drive the car. To do that, I checked how many fingers are touching the screen, and if there is more than 2 fingers, I do some math magic to move the camera sideways or zoom in and out when we pinch. As for interacting with the areas, I tried to keep things simple. And yes, I implemented an interface. I know it's a little bit anticlimax, but since touching the screen anywhere controls the car or the view, I couldn't think of a better idea. When we get near an interactive point, an interact button shows up, and when we go into cinematic mode, navigation buttons show up. Since navigation is a little bit harder on touch devices, I'm expecting users to get stuck more often, which is why I implemented an unstuck button. Whenever I detect that the user accelerates a lot without the car moving, I show up this button, and it's up to the user to click on it if he wants. Now the fun part, gamepads. Good news, browsers has been supporting gamepads for years. Bad news, it's very inconsistent between browsers, gamepad constructors, and even OS. I don't have many controllers to test, so I hope the three users that will test my portfolio with a gamepad will use a Xbox Series X controller or a PS5 controller. The way you retrieve data from the controller is quite simple. On each frame, you retrieve the list of active gamepads with navigator get gamepads. Each gamepad is an object with the various buttons and axes with their current state. Even better, there is a standard mapping. Unfortunately, for some reasons, Firefox doesn't support it with the PS5 controller. And even worse, the mapping changes between Windows and macOS, with absolutely no info and really weird behavior, like having the two axes of a joystick not following each other. So, I implemented a gamepad class to normalize those mappings as best as I could. I triggered some events, made all the data available for the rest of the experience. It took me a while to decide on the layout, but it was a good excuse to play games with vehicles. Here how it goes. For the sake of comprehension, I will use the PlayStation button names. Up and down arrows to accelerate or go backward. L2 and R2 also to accelerate and go backward, but with pressure control. Yep, you can go slowly. Square to break. Triangle to jump. Left, right arrows or left joystick to turn the wheels. Circle to boost or interact. Cross to exit. L1 and R1 to play with the hydraulics. Right joystick to move the camera. Right joystick press to zoom in and out, and every time you press it, it cycles between the two states. Select to respawn, and start to show the pause modal. It might take a few seconds to get the hang of it, but it feels quite natural, and anyway, I can easily change the layout whenever I want. Oh, and it worked with areas such as the lab and the projects. To explain the controls to the user, I already had this area. Interacting with it opens the controls modals with all three modes. I also created additional models to go with the keyboard. Not gonna lie, that gamepad took me a while to build. I don't like to use a modal to explain the controls, but there are so many buttons and ways to navigate compared to the old portfolio. I will have to sleep on it. With all the devices and resolutions supported, it was time to do the small changes in the interface to match the user stack. First, since all the inputs go through the inputs class, in there, I was able to easily test what the user uses to navigate and triggered event whenever the mode changes. It was then a matter of updating the world and UI. For the projects and lab blackboards, I created an atlas of icons and labels. I then switch between the meshes according to the mode and the type of gamepad. For touch screens, I completely remove the blackboard since buttons are at the bottom of the screen. For the control modals, on opening, I checked which mod is currently active and opened the corresponding tab so that the user immediately sees the right controls. Speaking of modals, since the button to exit is a cross, I didn't have to change it for the PlayStation controller, and if it's an Xbox controller, I displayed a A button. Finally, for the interactive points, when the user uses a gamepad, I changed the Enter key icon to a circle icon for the PlayStation controller and a B icon for the Xbox controller. And again, nothing for touch screens since there is an interact button at the bottom. And that's about it. I'm sure there are plenty of edge cases that I forgot, but I will be able to improve the responsiveness as I finish the whole project. I'm glad I got this out of the way, and I will get back to more interesting features now. There's a lot to do, but I'm still hoping to get the portfolio done before the end of the year. Don't forget to follow me on X or Blue Sky for granular updates. And if you wonder why it took me so long to get this new devlog out, it's because I was busy doing some side quests. In this case, I was working on my main bedroom. You wanna see? See you in the next devlog.